Welcome to Sunday School, everyone. You guys come on in. Got some notes going around somewhere. We're having a good time, y'all. So welcome to Sunday School this morning. So if y'all have been to Sunday School for any amount of time, you know that I suffer with something called OCD, which would be obsessive commenting disorder. So feel free to... Now that I'm not out there, you guys feel free to participate this morning if we need to. And definitely a shout-out correction if you hear something crazy. So now we're continuing our study of the attributes of God this morning. This is one of my favorite topics. Oh, we got somebody in the back already. Pastor. That was it. Yeah, it was subtle. I told you. Yeah, it was subtle. That's all right. So now we're talking about the attributes. This definitely is one of my favorite topics of study. Primarily because it's a study of who God is, right? So not who I think he is or who you may think or feel that he is, but who God himself has revealed himself to be through his word. I think it's very easy, especially in our modern time, to base our theology on our own opinions or maybe the opinions of someone else or something that we grew up with of who God is. But obviously it's very important to use scripture as our foundation there. Recently, Ligonier Ministries put out a survey called the State of Theology Survey, which is something they do every couple years. Essentially, they send out these packets, and you get percentages on what people are professing to believe. And this one, I don't know if any of y'all heard any of that, but it's shocking in the negative sense for sure. Because, I mean, we're not talking about questions like, you know, that are debated amongst like Arminianism or Calvinism or things like that. It's like, is Jesus God, right? And you would think on a question like that, like the evangelical side, oh man, 90% would probably agree with this, right? It's like scary, dude. It's like in the 50 percentile of professing Christians who would say that Jesus was a good teacher, but he was not God, right? So it's foundational questions like that that it's a scary thing to see where we're at overall in our state of theology today. So definitely... Another reason why things like this are important to go over. One of my favorite theologians, R.C. Sproul, in his book Knowing Scripture says, "No Christian can avoid theology. Every Christian is a theologian. Perhaps not a theologian in the technical or professional sense, but a theologian nevertheless. The issue for Christians is not whether we're going to be theologians, but whether we are going to be good theologians or bad ones." So I would definitely agree with Dr. Sproul on that note. Even in speaking with people about some of the harder things in scripture, you hear some things like, well, I don't think I could believe in a God like that, right? Or my God would never do that. As if there's like another option of gods that we're talking about here, or as if the existence of God is based on our belief in him. So statements like that, they're proof that when left to our own devices, we will fashion an image of God that matches our own ideas and most times turns a blind eye to our own sinful desires, right? At that point, our little g God is not Yahweh, the God of Scripture. I think that's why studies like the attributes are so important. We're able to look to some of these great writings like the Attributes of God by A.W. Pink, Knowledge of the Holy by A.W. Tozer. Something about the A.W.'s, man. Other historic writings like our own 1689 London Baptist Confession of Faith that we read through each week, we don't look to these resources as the ultimate authority, obviously, but we can trust them because they are saturated in Scripture, which is the ultimate authority. Another reason I love this study is it encourages or really forces you to consistently consider Scripture as a whole, right? You're not going to find a chapter in the Bible called the triune nature of God or the aseity of God. These are concepts and truths about God's character that he reveals progressively throughout his word over and over. I'm grateful, obviously, for church fathers, theologians who painstakingly searched the scriptures and devoted many of years of their own life to ensure that these truths about God are passed on to the next generation. Last reason I would say I really love studies like this, like the attributes, and really much of the Reformed tradition, is that it encourages the use of your mind, right? Jesus himself says, Matthew 22:37, and he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. I think many times people act as if faith cannot exist within the same realm as logic and reason. So kind of like the contrast that's often made between belief in God versus science, right? As if those things are just polar opposites. When, honestly, the more we find out about science, the more, just like Paul says in Romans 1, the more that it points to the intelligent design of an actual creator. But this is not just something that's limited to unbelievers or atheists that do this, I think. I would say that Christians, as Christians, we tend to kind of do this all the time. So many Christians, I would say, place too much emphasis on having an encounter with God. They're usually very emotional, feelings-oriented. Not that we never engage our emotions, our feelings when dealing with subjects like this, but it's almost as if you think too hard about it, you're limiting your faith, right? Like you don't have enough faith because you're just using too much head in the process. But the Bible does not say that you have to unhitch your mind or set aside logic or reason to have faith, right? Joshua 1:8 says, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Other times the phrase, you have to have faith, I think, can be used as a cop-out for our own laziness in studying God's word, myself included here. I'm ashamed to say that in times in the past, someone will maybe approach me with a legitimate question that they're obviously wrestling with, that scripture actually does have an answer for, and, you know, what's my default? Slap them on the back and say, hey, brother, you just have to have faith, right? That's like a get-out-of-jail-free card, essentially, for me as evangelism, if you will. But thinking back on that, it makes me cringe, and it makes me sad, too, because those are real friends in those moments that are coming to me with a question that, again, I could have pointed them to somewhere in scripture at the time. Chose not to. I chose the easy way out, right? So that's definitely not me fulfilling Christ's command in Matthew 23 when he says to, you know, love the Lord with all your heart, soul, and mind. So I cannot truly love someone unless I know them. So if I am to love God with all my heart, soul, and my mind, obviously I need to then get to know him. And you do that through scripture. So, anyway, there's some reasons why I really love things like the attributes of God, these kind of teachings, because it just really puts us in that place. Anybody have any questions or comments before we dive into our subject this morning? Wow. Rob? So far in the study, we've talked about the aseity of God, Brother Laramie, the existing of and from himself. We've hit the self-sufficiency of God, triune nature of God, solitariness of God, God's omnipresence, the decrees of God, the providence of God, and then Brother David last week with God's omniscience, or God being all-knowing. So today we are focusing on the foreknowledge of God. It is important to remember, just like when we would go through the study of the Trinity, that God is not a God of parts, okay? So it's the same thing with his attributes. He's not 10% love, 10% wrath, 10% sovereign. Each attribute of God is expressed in its fullness, perfectly and righteously in God, okay? That can kind of be difficult to wrap our finite minds around, how each thing could be 100% of something within the whole. But it should be very comforting for us as believers. Our main passage today, we're going to be looking at Romans 8:29, and it's chock full of topics here that we're going to go over. So, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. So right off the bat here, we see two big theological concepts. We see predestination and foreknowledge. So we're primarily talking about foreknowledge, but really I feel like you can't fully go through that without bleeding over on some of these other topics. So predestination, that's a concept that all people should be familiar with to some degree. The idea of a person being destined for greatness, right? Word of faith and prosperity teachers love destiny, right? Destiny sells books, right? I did a quick Google search on just like Destiny or whatever, and popped up three smiley preacher sermon titles. Your destiny outweighs your history. Down is not your destiny, and feed your destiny. So everybody loves that idea, right? The idea of being destined for something greater than wherever you're at right now. Foreknowledge, however, it's a little harder to understand than that, I would say. So I was born in 1984, right? I'm a child of the late 80s, early 90s. So, of course, I was raised on the classics. Star Wars, right? Lord of the Rings, Ninja Turtles, Back to the Future, Jurassic Park, the good stuff. One book when I was younger that blew my mind was reading H.G. Wells' Time Machine, right? I don't know if you guys heard about that one. So the idea that the past and the future are these places that can actually be visited if you had the right equipment to do so, and then that you could even alter them was just something that blew my mind as a kid, right? So it's safe to say that when I come across foreknowledge, my initial understanding is tainted with science fiction, you know, or pop culture, I guess you could say. However, time travel is not what scripture has in mind here. The most common error among Christians regarding predestination, I would say, comes from a misunderstanding of or misreading of Romans 8:29. So the passage shows us clearly that God's predestination comes from his foreknowledge. But people, I believe, confuse foreknowledge here with foresight. Okay, we'll kind of dive into what that is, but the common misunderstanding, and unfortunately this is probably the prevalent view, the majority of evangelicalism, is that God peered down the corridors of time, foresaw who would accept his free gift of salvation, and then based on their decision to accept Christ, predestines them for election as his chosen people. Of course, all this happening in eternity past before creation starts. So I believe there's three main issues that we come across if we read Romans 8:29 that way. First, God created time, okay? So God is eternal. Time has a definite beginning and a definite end. So if God created time, then it would stand to reason that he exists outside of time. So if God's perspective of time is as a complete whole, knows the end from the beginning, he doesn't need to insert himself into time, I guess you could say, to try to see what will or will not take place. Isaiah 46:9-10, remember the former things of old, for I am God, there is no other. I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will accomplish all my purpose. For Psalm 139:16, your eyes saw my unformed substance, in your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. Right, so I think that's pretty clear. God does not need to insert himself into time to see what will or will not take place. Two, this is going to touch a little bit on what Brother David talked about last week with God's omniscience. God cannot learn things, okay? So we've already established that again with God's omniscience. He is all-knowing. If God is all-knowing, then he cannot learn something that he did not already know. He would then, by definition, not be all-knowing, right? The idea that God needed to look into the future to see who would or would not choose him means he didn't know beforehand who would choose him, right? It's kind of like you got to kind of logically take some of these things to their end conclusion to understand really kind of the fallacy of what we're looking at in that situation. Three, I would say that it denies salvation by faith alone in Christ alone. So scripture is abundantly clear that our salvation is based on Christ's righteousness alone, not by works or by our own righteousness. So if God's predestination of who will or will not be saved is based on some future action on our part, then we've now technically played a role on why we should be saved, a role in our own salvation. Romans 3:20 says, "For by works of the law no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin." Ephesians 2:8-9, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is a gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast." To quote A.W. Pink on the subject of foreknowledge, this would be the the guy that wrote The Attributes of God. God did not elect any sinner because he foresaw that he would believe. For the simple but sufficient reason that no sinner ever does believe until God gives him faith. Just as no man sees until God gives him sight. Sight is God's gift. Seeing is the consequence of my using his gift. So faith is God's gift. Believing is the consequence of my using his gift. So we have a bit of a kind of a what came first, the chicken or the egg situation here. So some people would look at this and say, why does that even matter, right? Like, it may seem on the surface like kind of a moot point or, you know, a small thing. But the end result, again, of how somebody views this passage and these concepts can lead them into some serious error on things that are not just, you know, periphery things, but central gospel issues or questions. So anyway, before we keep going there, does anybody have anything you want to say or questions about what we're talking about here so far? Man, I like that. Got it, I mean, you know. Now, so Romans 8:29, what it's not saying is that God foreknew certain decisions we would make. It does not say that God foresaw our faith and then based on that predestines us. The passage tells us that God foreknew certain people. So to understand foreknowledge, we need to look at what the Bible means when it speaks about knowledge or specifically to know someone or something. I kind of touched on this some the last time I taught something from the pulpit, which was during the biblical sexuality, I think is what we had titled it, and speaking of Sodom and Gomorrah, another fun topic there. But we came across that to know, right? Like, what does that mean biblically? This is where I'm going to have to lean on other pastors, theologians, and scholars, because my original Greek and Hebrew are a little rusty. By that, I mean they're virtually non-existent. So the meaning of foreknowledge is pretty straightforward as far as the English language is concerned. So to know before. But there are some intricacies, I believe, that are lost in translation from the original language that we do need to look at to actually understand that fully. So in the original Greek language that the New Testament's written in, the word foreknowledge is a verb with a prefix placed in front. So the main verb is gnosko, which means to know in a personal love relationship. So the same words used when speaking of a husband and a wife in a very intimate physical relationship. So to know that spouse in a way that you would know nobody else, or you should know nobody else. The prefix pro being before, in English, this would be like us using the word pre, so a preview or to view something before, right? The original language word for foreknowledge in total then is prognosko, which would mean those whom God previously chose to love. In the original Hebrew, the language of the Old Testament, so when we had looked at the Sodom and Gomorrah passage, the same word there is yada, but they're the same word. One's in Greek, one's in the original Hebrew. So this is where some people might get rubbed the wrong way, okay? But hey, we're going to look at scripture here, so it's not my opinion. But this is an exclusive word, okay? So if I have to make a choice, then that means that I'm choosing something over something else, all right? When a man chooses his wife, that means there's an entire planet of women who were not chosen. So this means that when God chose his elect, all those who, again, the elect, when we say that, we're talking about everyone who would be saved from the beginning of time to the end of time, okay? That is the elect, God's chosen. He chose to love them in ways that he does not love others. This means that when, let's just say, don't take my word for it. Let's see what scripture has to say about it, right? Before y'all get y'all's pitchforks out and whatnot. Genesis 4:1. Now Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, okay? So that passage by itself, pretty obvious that Adam did not just know about his wife and then a child was miraculously conceived, okay? Spoiler alert, a child is conceived from the intimate physical relationship between a man and a woman, okay? And it's, yeah. Man and woman, that's another, I'm not going to go on that topic, it will be here all morning, but This is repeated in verse later on in verse 25 of the same chapter there. And Adam knew his wife again, and she bore a son. Okay? So when we understand this and come across the word foreknowledge, it is quite obvious that it does not mean foresight. To quote Dr. Stephen Lawson on this same subject, he said that Eve would never have become pregnant with just foresight, right? So in the Bible, the word know means to love in the most intimate relationship possible. It is also synonymous, though, with being chosen. So I want to look at Amos 3:2 in two different translations here. Amos 3:2 says, "You only have I known of all the families of the earth." This is God speaking to Israel. "Therefore I will punish you for all your iniquities." Okay? Another translation of the same passage says, "You only have I chosen of all the families of the earth. Therefore I will punish you for all your sins." So we see the same word being used there, but in one translation it's known, and the other translation it's chosen. So to know, biblically, is to choose to love. So God did not love all the other families of the earth the same way that he loved Israel. I think that's obvious when we look through all of Scripture, right? God didn't love the Canaanites the same way that he loved Israel, right? He didn't love the Egyptians the same way that he loved Israel. It was very obvious that God demonstrated his love for Israel over the other nations, choosing them over other people. This usage of the word to know continues in the New Testament. We see it at the incarnation. Matthew 1:24-25. "When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus." So Mary had not been known by a man. Obviously, Joseph knew the woman he was to marry to some degree, right? But he did not yet know her in a deeply intimate personal relationship as a man knows his wife. So we see it used again by Jesus himself at the end of the Sermon on the Mount. Now, side note, I don't mean to keep doing this with this passage, but like the last three things that I've prepared, this has come up. So, I mean, I don't know, maybe the Lord thinks that I need to hear this as much as you guys this morning. So Matthew 7:21-23. "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, cast out demons in your name, and do many mighty works in your name?' Then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness.'" So, very sobering passage, scariest verse in Scripture to me. Obviously, Jesus is God, or maybe not obviously according to the survey, but just so y'all know, Jesus is God. God knows every hair on these men's head that he's speaking to here. He knows every thought, every inner desire of the heart that they've ever had. So what could he possibly mean by "I never knew you," right? Obviously, the connotation there is that he means I never had an intimate relationship with you, right? I'm sure you've heard the phrase, "It's not religion, it's a relationship." A little bit cringy. Technically, it is religion, right? I think that gets a little cliche in its usage, but there is a grain of truth there, right? It's, while it is religion, to be known and to know and to be known by your Creator is a very intimate relationship. John 10:14-15. "I am the good shepherd. I know my own. My own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay my life down for the sheep." John 10:27-30. "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one." So, in looking at what we've looked at so far here, honestly, I have a hard time wrapping my mind around how somebody can consider themselves a student of the Word, okay? I don't mean like seminary student, per se. I'm just mean a professing Christian who is seeking to honor Christ with their life and remain faithful to Scripture. I don't see how somebody can have that motivation and then come across these verses and still read Romans 8:29 as God foreseeing a decision. instead of God actually choosing to love his people before he created them. God chose his people. We did not choose him. So this is uncomfortably, I would say, clear in Romans 9. We look at God's sovereign choice of Jacob over Esau from the womb. Pulling out the heavy hitters here this morning. So Romans 9, 10 through 16. And not only so, but also when Rebekah had conceived children by one man, our forefather Isaac, though they were not yet born and had done nothing either good or bad, pay attention to that part, in order that God's purpose of election might continue, not because of works, but because of him who calls. She was told, the older will serve the younger. As it is written, Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated. What shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? By no means. For he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So then it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. I mean, that's crystal clear to me. I mean, it's black and white right there in Scripture. I think one reason that we as just fallen humans struggle with the idea of foreknowledge or predestination, election, or really just God's sovereignty overall, even the gospel, is that we live in a performance-based world or society, if you will. We do something, and then based on what we do, we're either rewarded or reprimanded for whatever we did or did not do. This starts as children, follows us through school, into career as adults. I mean, our whole life is a performance-based life for the most part. So it's very hard to accept that the grounds of our salvation or damnation would be based on something outside of our own performance or our own ability to or inability to keep God's law, right? That goes against everything that we just think about. But the Bible is very clear when it teaches that our salvation is based on Christ's righteousness, not our righteousness, and our inability to keep God's law. The Bible also clearly teaches that God chose us as his elect before creation began. So far before any action or inaction on our part, right? I want to look at kind of the main objection that usually comes up when we talk about this, but does anybody have any questions or comments about what we've discussed so far this morning? Got something? What you got, brother? Yeah, I think Laramie's saying there is essentially it is based on performance in the sense of all have sinned, come short of the glory of God, right? Perfection is the standard. No man can meet the standard. Primarily with the Jacob and Esau, I think, is where people have a misunderstanding of just how big of a deal sin is, right? You think of sinning and you're like, okay, well, an infant child, they can't do anything. I mean, they're infants, right? They can't lie or steal or essentially, right? And so we think of physically committing an act of sin, not the fact that what Scripture says is we're born dead in our sins, right? We're our nature, we're naughty by nature, if you will. 90s reference there. But so anyway, yeah, I mean, definitely agree. In that sense, it is performance-based because all have sinned, right? But our initial election, if you will, is not based on either an action or an inaction. It's based on God's good counsel, right? His own will. So let's look at the main objection that usually comes up when we talk about things like foreknowledge or predestination or sovereignty. Main objection is usually around the perceived violation of free will. Okay. Again, I'm pulling out the heavy hitters here, hitting all the hot topics this morning. So we talk about free will, okay? If God predestines people to salvation, then what about free will? Okay, what about choice? Are we just pre-programmed robots? The main question overall, I think, would be how do the choices of man exist within the sovereignty of God? So majority of theologians and great minds throughout church history would actually all answer this question the same way. We don't know. So that's thank you for coming this morning. That's it. No. Now, this is one of the profound mysteries in Scripture that we come across, something that's referred to in theology as divine concurrence. It's used to explain the reality that God and human beings are both acting at the same time so that the Lord's plan is fulfilled and our choices and responsibility for those choices are truly our own, right? A great example of this would be the Pharisees and the Romans' role that they play in the crucifixion of Jesus. So the atrocities that were carried out on our Lord, the only truly innocent man on the earth that's ever walked the earth, were most definitely horrible sins, right? Committed directly, physically by the Romans and indirectly by the Pharisees as a result of their false accusations against Christ. So the blood of Christ very literally was on their hands, right? And figuratively. And they rightly were held responsible in God's eyes for that sin, okay? And yet they were fulfilling God's will that his son would be crushed for our iniquities as the lamb. Again, it says slain from the foundations of the earth, right? So we got to remember, Christ was not plan B because Adam and Eve ate the fruit, right? Before creation, the plan within God was to send Christ for us, right? So evil men plotted and committed the unjust murder of Jesus out of their own free will choices, and in doing so fulfilled the will of God, and God was not guilty in the process of sin. So if you guys can explain how that worked, let me know, because that's, again, it's a mystery. How does all that play out, right? We see this kind of concurrence, though. Oh, you got something for me, brother? You know how. Okay, go ahead. Oh, get out of jail free card. All right. You got me? Yeah. That is one of the, joking aside, that is one of the elements where you do have to have faith. Like, we come across things in Scripture where, you know, we can try to logic and reason it out and you know, how does the Trinity truly work, right? How does man's choice, God's responsibility, God's will, sovereign will, and man's responsibility and choices, that's some areas where you do have to have faith, actually, to just understand, hey, I don't know how it works. Thank God that it does work, right? But we see this kind of concurrence over and over in Scripture, not just in an area like this. So I have a couple little rapid fire questions here that I want to just throw out to help hopefully illustrate this point. Okay, don't think too deeply on it. Just let's see what the answers are here. So who wrote the book of Romans? Anybody want to throw that one out? Aiden, who wrote the book of Romans? Paul. So you stand by that. Paul wrote the book of Romans, right? Okay, I see what you did there. Did he write it by himself? Did Paul write Romans by himself? Okay, good job. So let's, okay. So here we go. Is every word in Romans from the mind and vocabulary of Paul? I'm saying, right? Okay, it is, right? So yeah, every word that was written in Romans came from Paul's mind, from his vocabulary. It is Paul writing. Is every word in Romans inspired by the Spirit of God? Okay, how can that be? How does that work? I don't mean to put you on the spot, brother. Nobody knows that. So let's look at it this way. So here's a bit of a tricky question. So do you have any role in sustaining your salvation? Okay, you sure? Okay. Okay, on the one hand, you do. We're told to persevere, right? If you persevere to the end, you will be saved. And yet on the other hand, you are kept by his power to the end, ensuring that you will be saved, okay? So just do that to illustrate. We come across this kind of difficulty in most of the major doctrines, if not all maybe, in Christianity, where you have human responsibility and the sovereign power of God, okay? There's a human element and there's a divine element. So how about when it comes to our own salvation? Are we saved because the Spirit of God regenerated our heart? Or are we saved because we repented and believed the gospel? Yes and yes. Good job, Laramie. So, yeah, I mean, honestly, it's when you look at that, there's always this human element and this divine element. We can't explain how that all works, but we know that it does. So, kind of bringing this back around to the main topic at hand, foreknowledge. What is the foreknowledge of God? Okay, what does Romans 8:29 actually mean? In my own words here, it means that before the world began in eternity past, the eternal creator of all things, Yahweh, the great I am, made a choice to love you. He chose to love you with an everlasting love, expressed to the fullness within his perfect holiness. Your name was written in the Lamb's Book of Life, not just before you ever physically sinned, but before you ever existed. Now, do we really believe that? Like, are we living our life like we believe that that is true? And trust me, when I ask that question myself, I'm in full view of who I'm talking about here. I'm asking myself these same questions. So when I myself become complacent and go long periods of time without seeking the face of God through his word, getting distracted by life, family, social media, right, running a business, am I truly living like I believe that what scripture says is true? Just because we are foreknown, if you are a believer today, just because we are foreknown and predestined by God, and our salvation is secure in Christ, it does not mean that we as believers are able to just coast through life without responsibility. We are called to persevere until the end. The definition in the dictionary of persevere is to continue in a course of action even in the face of difficulty or with little or no prospect of success. That does not sound like coasting usually, right? That doesn't sound like an easy life. Paul called it fighting the good fight or running the race, right? These are violent sometimes and exhausting tasks. The Christian life is not a hands-off kind of life. But we are promised in Romans 8, if we look at our original passage and just kind of back it up a little bit and back and forward, Romans 8, 28 through 30, says, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son in order that we might be the firstborn among many brothers. I'm sorry, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. Those whom he called, he also justified. Those whom he justified, he also glorified. So this is a promise in Romans 8, 28 here that if we were foreknown, then we were predestined. When it says to be conformed to the image of his son, that's the process of sanctification that, you know, while justification or salvation before God in that sense is a one-time event, sanctification is going to last the rest of our life until we're called home, right? In some form, to some degree, everybody's on a different track there, I would say, pace, if you will, but we are being conformed to the image of his son. And then when it says, you know, if he predestined us, he called us. If he called us, he justified us. And those who he justified, he glorified. Glorified meaning, you know, when we die, we're met with Christ face to face. So this isn't like suggesting, hey, if he predestined you, you got a really good chance of probably being glorified, right? And it's definite language that we see in the passage here. So I think we all need to be reminded who this God is that we serve, right? He's not what a lot of people make him out to seem like today. He's not weak by any means. I mean, if he called us, he says he will glorify us. That doesn't mean if he called us and we just screwed up one too many times in life, well, he's probably not going to be able to take us home, right? I encourage you guys as we go through this study, this is all I got for you this morning, but as we go through the study of the attributes, just to dig in deeper on this and to really devote yourself to knowing this God that we serve, right? And not just that, but being known by him. So that's what I got for y'all on foreknowledge this morning. Anybody have any kind of questions or comments before I cry up here? The last one got me. You got something, brother? At the decision. No, yeah, it's definitely, you go through that stage when you come across some of these truths and you're like mad because you're like, man, I've lived 30-something years of my life like believing the incorrect view on this doctrine or whatever, right? And then, you know, one thing that's encouraging to me, and I have no seminary degree by far at all, anything that I, you know, it's God's grace that I even know anything about anything I'm talking about up here. But for me, that was from like just a deep dive on what do I actually believe, right? So I was having this conversation with a creed here recently, came across someone who should be much more schooled in theology than we are and had some of these concepts, right? They're just way off what actual scripture teaches, you know? And it's sad because it's like, I mean, and I'm not trying to build myself up here at all, trust me on that, but I'm just saying like, why on that subject, why am I like, more of an authority on that subject than this person, right? This dude has schooling, and it's by the grace of God, but I'm like, dude, that's like every believer's responsibility, right? Like, we are to have a defense for this faith, right? What we profess to believe, we need to be able to back it up with scripture, right? It's not just a pastor's job or somebody who's completed years of seminary school or has a degree, MDiv or whatever, right? Like, if I am a professing Christian, there is a responsibility for me to know God and to be able to have this defense when I'm talking with people, right? And not just out of an opinion, but scripture, right? I don't like arguing. I'm a very non-confrontational person, but for some reason, when it comes to scripture, I'm argumentative now all of a sudden or whatever, right? But it's like, you know, if scripture is the foundation, it's like you can disagree with me on this, but if I'm keep coming back to scripture, your real disagreement is with God. It's not with me who's standing in front of you, right? I kind of rabbit trailed there, but yeah, definitely. I don't know. I do want to highlight the fact that it's not just somebody that teaches the word of God that has that responsibility really to know God, you know? A convicting thing I saw come up that John Piper said was, something along the lines of, like, social media will be a great example of how, you know, at the end time, we had all this time in the world, but we didn't utilize it correctly, right? I'm butchering the quote, but essentially that's what it's saying, right? It's like, we've got the same 24 hours in every day, you know, and yet none of us have time, right? But if we don't make a priority as believers to know God and to study his word, that's our bread of life, right? It's like, that's our source of nutrition as a believer. So we're walking around as emaciated believers, right? Wondering why you know, we don't know what to do in these situations when we're confronted with a trial or something. You know, it's like, well, how much word have you been actually hiding in your heart for that? We kind of talked about that on Wednesday. Like, how much is in here from the Spirit of God to pull from to remind you of what you're going through in your trial or whatever? So, yeah, I think that's good, brother. Anybody else got anything they want to say before we go this morning? All right, awesome. Well, thank you guys for allowing me to get up here. I truly do not take it lightly, this standing in front of y'all and teaching you something about the Word of God. So let's just pray real quick, and we'll dismiss this morning. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity we have to come before you and learn this morning. I pray that the things that you illuminated to me in my study this last week, Lord, that you'll just let it sink into our hearts and our minds as we go through our week. And just pray that the rest of the service, Lord God, obviously your will be done, Lord, but just help us to be receptive to what you would say this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.